our tardiness, we did have an executive session. No votes, of course, were taken in executive session. And following the committee meetings, we will again move for the remainder of two items on our executive session. So no items require a vote. First is the appointment of various boards and commissions. First, we have a Combinations Tax Advisory Committee. We have two bios, Derek Norris, Doug Cobb.
Mr. Chairman, I waive rules and nominate Mr. Philip Cobb for the at-large position.
We have a motion and a second on Mr. Cobb. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? All those affirmative, and it passes. Anything else? What about Derek Norris? Anyone know Derek? All right, we have Airport Environs Planning Commission.
Chairman, waive rules, nominate Elect Carter Smith.
Second.
Motion and a second on Mr. Carter Smith. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes. Alcohol, Drug, and Abuse, we have a Commission Appeal. Court of Appeals, we need to fill a real estate position on Board of Appeals. Building Code, Board of Appeals and Adjustments, we have three bios for reappointment.
Mr. Chairman, I waive rules and nominate Mr. James R. Greer, Engineer Representative.
A motion on Mr. James R. Greer.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes. Have a couple.
Waive rules and nominate Mr. John Henderson, Architect.
I have a motion and a second on Mr. John Henderson. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes. Next, we have Community Development Advisory Committee. We have three persons.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to waive rules and nominate Ben Hines.
I have a motion on Mr. Hines. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to waive the rules and nominate Elect Susan Gammons.
Got a motion and a second on Susan Gammons. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes.
Mr. Chairman, I waive rules and nominate Ms. Romesina Holman, District City Representative.
Have a motion on Ms. Holman and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes. Thank you. Springs Fingerville.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that we waive the rules and nominate Mr. Craig McDowell.
Second.
Have a motion and a second on Craig McDowell. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes. All right, so we have a couple coming up on downtown Airport Advisory. Employee agreements, we've had one individual to resign. We need to fill that position. Hobbiesville.
Still waiting. Mr. Chairman.
Right. Team Up Community
Action. Mr. Chairman, I ask that we waive the rules and nominate Elect Mr. Jerome Rice Jr.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on Mr. Jerome Rice Jr. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? Affirmative, and it passes. Twin Lake Special Tax.
Finally, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to waive the rules and nominate Ms. Barbara Stanton.
All right, we have Barbara Stanton. State members. Will we have a second?
Second.
We have a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? A vote affirmative, and it passes. Thank you. Next item. Receive information, take desired action in reference to a resolution supporting state efforts to find solutions to the funding needs for state maintained and operated roads and bridges without transferring the burden to local governments, and opposing any actions taken by General Assembly that through lack of state funding will lead to increased taxes on the citizens. Have that resolution here. Do we have a motion?
I can make that motion.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Now, any other discussion? Okay. vote of affirmative, and it passes. Thank you. Item five regarding board appointments with regional hospital.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we postpone until May meeting.
So you have a motion? And a second. I think there were a few questions that arose that the few council members wanted additional answers, so that being said, any other comments? Ma'am?
Just want to clarify, that would be the regular schedule.
Yeah, regular schedule, maybe.
That's what it said. That's the way I understood it anyway. All right, they have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, or vote affirmative, and it passes. Thank you. Next, we have economic recruitment and development. Honorable David Britt, Chairman, Michael Brown, Roger Nutt, members. Mr. Britt?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Got a request to approve the bylaws in reference to the bylaws of the Upstate Workforce Investment Board, the WIB, consortium between Cherokee, Spartanburg, and Union Counties for the implementation of public law 11-113-128. Do I hear move we approve the bylaws?
So moved.
Second.
Motion made and second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We recommend full council at 5:30. Second item also relates to the WIB. We have a request to approve the agreement in reference to the consortium and administrative agreement between the Upstate Workforce Investment Board and the chief elected officials of Cherokee, Spartanburg, and Union Counties. We're here to approve the agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made and second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. We recommend that full council. Next item also relates to the WIB. Do I hear a motion to approve and authorize County Council Chairman and the County Administrator to sign in reference to the Workforce Development Area Designation Petition for Upstate Workforce Investment Board?
So moved.
Motion been made.
Second.
Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We'll recommend full council at 5:30. And the last item, we have a request and both take information and desired action in reference to a request by REWA, which is a renewable water resources group, to enter into an agreement naming either a chairman or a county administrator to sign this agreement. Do I hear move that we approve?
So moved.
Second.
Motion made and second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
And we'll recommend full council at 5:30. Mr. Chairman, that concludes our committee meeting.
Next, we have Public Health and Human Services. Honorable Justin Bradley, Chairman, Michael Brown, Bob Walker, members. Mr. Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First item on the agenda is to receive information in reference to mental health in Merica, Spartanburg County. We have Ms. Nancy Holland, Executive Director, to present.
Yes, I can see you. First of all, thank you for your time today and for listening to us. We're here to let you know who we are, what our mission is, and a couple things that we'd like to ask your support in. Mental Health America Spartanburg is a satellite from Mental Health America in South Carolina, which we're part of a national organization. We are a nonprofit. Actually, Mental Health America previously had a presence in Spartanburg County from 1950 until it merged with Carolina Counseling and became the PACE Center. When the PACE Center lost their funding in 2011, and Mental Health America went away as well. Thanks to the efforts of the Spartanburg Behavioral Task Force and a subsequent behavioral needs assessment, they determined that there was no organization in Spartanburg County doing the work that we do, which our mission is to promote positive mental health through advocacy, education, and service. So there was no one being advocates for people with mental illness, as well as no one educating the community about the needs. One thing that came out of that needs assessment that's pretty staggering is that they determined that only 15.9% of the people in Spartanburg County who suffered from mental illness were actually receiving services. And we believe there's several reasons for that. One of them, probably the primary one of, is the shortage of resources, which actually is a nationwide problem as far as the being uninsured. Some places take people on Medicaid, some don't. It's just a whole plethora of reasons that a person with mental illness has to go through or work through to find out, where they can go. The other reason we feel is because there's still such a stigma around mental illness, and the people may suffer, their families may know they're suffering, but they just don't like to step out and reach for help. And so that's one of the missions that we have too, is to reduce the stigma around mental illness, to get people in the community talking about it, to find out that, you know, mental illness is real and treatable. It's a disease of the brain. These people did not choose to have a mental illness, and that it's okay to talk about it. And it's okay to encourage them to go for help. After the behavioral task force said that they wanted us back, then we had to get funding, of course, to start up. So we had an additional grant from Spartanburg Regional Foundation, and then we had additional grants from the joint funders, which would be the Mayor Black Foundation, again, the Spartanburg Regional Foundation, Spartanburg County Foundation, and the United Way. So along with that money and a donation from Mental Health America of South Carolina and the New Day Clubhouse, we were able to become reestablished. At that point, an advisory board was assembled, and they worked on the issues. I was hired in July 2014. SADAC was kind enough to give us an in-kind office, so we have been in operation since. Now, during that time, and I'm a staff of one, which is fine, but I have a lot of help from my advisory board and my chair. Mary Miles is right there. So we've been actually going out into the community, meeting the civic organizations and different groups, just to let people who we are and what we're doing. So that's, you know, we've been successful with that. We offer educational courses in suicide prevention and stigma reduction. These are geared toward, the stigma reduction is geared toward actually adolescents and younger. I was recently certified as an instructor for mental health first aid, which is an international course. And we have been blessed that the United Way has offered to support. We've got our first session coming up Wednesday. In addition to that, the city of Spartanburg has applied for a Department of Justice grant in order to present this mental health first aid to all law enforcement, city and county, probation and parole, DSS, and the Department of Juvenile Justice. We'll know about that grant in October. It's a two-year grant, and before they submitted it, they asked if I would be willing to train about 500 people in that course. And law enforcement is one group that have expressed an interest in learning more about mental illness, so we're really hopeful that that will go through and that they will be able to come to the course. One of the most recent things that we've done to reduce stigma is that we found a documentary. The name of it is From Bull Street to Main Street, and it shows the progression of the treatment in mental illness from the 1800s. And the purpose of this was to reduce the stigma. We premiered it at the United Way. I've shown it to several civic organizations with several more on the docket to present to. We're available to present it to any size group that will watch, that will see it. I will send Debbie the link to it, and I hope that that County Council will also review it and get the message that we're sending out. We're here today just to ask for your support, just to know what we're doing, and to ask for your support. If anything, if any issues come up around behavior or mental health, that you will support us, and that you'll also support our efforts in reducing the stigma. So we will be glad to give you any information that you need in order to do that. We do have one or two, several exciting things coming up in May. May is Mental Health Month, and it has been for about 60 years. The mayor is going to sign a proclamation on Morgan Square on May the 5th at 11 o'clock. You're all invited. We would really like, you know, a good crowd to come out. The fountain will be tinted green because that's the color that stands for mental illness. There'll be bows on the trees. So we're going full out to let people know, you know, who we are. And not only who we are, but the other mental health agencies and organizations in Spartanburg. The proclamation will be around all of them. I just got news before I came over here. There's a gentleman, he's actually in recovery, is the term that we use. He was diagnosed with schizophrenia as a young man. He is now a peer support specialist for the Charleston Department of Mental Health. He, this will be his second year he's done this, but he's going to ride his bicycle from Charleston to Spartanburg to bring awareness to mental health. I extended an invitation to them to, when they arrive in Spartanburg, to ride on Morgan Square again, so we can give him a warm state welcome. And I just found out that he's excited about that, so you're invited for that as well. He'll be here on May the 4th, somewhere between 2 and 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Any questions?
Thank you, Ms. Holland. I appreciate what you're doing to raise awareness. It's definitely an important issue in our county. Any of the other members of the committee have any questions?
You say you're a member of the one, as far as employee, but you're the only
employee. It's Spartanburg. Yes.
Are you going to do all those classes?
Yeah. Jane Lipscomb with the city and I have, we've actually sat down and said, how many days a week will it take for you to do these? I do have a colleague in Columbia who's going to co-facilitate the one that we're doing Wednesday, but I can't very well ask her to come up here because I'll probably do it 1 week. And just to get that out, yeah. You have to be a certified instructor, so it's not something that I can train other people to do. Yeah.
Well, I was
thanks for your concern.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you for all you do.
Just, I'm not on the committee, but I want to commend you, Nancy, for your presentation. You know, not reading notes, you have it. It's obvious you've got your heart. You believe in it. Thank you for doing what you do as well.
Thank you. I've got a brochure with my contact information on it. I'll leave you, Debbie. I'll make sure you
have that. Ms. Holland.
Thank you. Yes.
Do you have a long-term plan to expand your staff? I know you said 15.9% based upon your assessment.
Well, we don't do counseling, so expanding our staff in that direction is really not, that would go against what we're really for. Okay, that's sort of what happened when MHA merged with Carolina Counseling. The mission of MHA got kind of, you know, forgotten about and turned into Western Counseling. To answer your question though, and to Jane's point as well, as soon as we get better known and we start doing more programs, and if we can get the funding, there's a possibility that we will hire. We will be looking for volunteers to do the educational course that we take into the schools. So that is good, because I cannot do all that.
So you do have a built-in volunteer component in work that you got?
We're working on it. Yes, yes.
Well, thank you so much. I mean, it's a highly needed, often undiscussed.
Well, thank you. And thank you for your concern about my time.
Well, I think I can speak for all of us in council. We've known for a long time that it's a weakness that this state has as far as the care and the delivery of services for mental health. This happened several years ago, where for some reason the emphasis on mental health seemed to deteriorate, and I'm so glad to see that it's being brought to the forefront again.
And one of the most recent negative things that happened with mental health in South Carolina is that Medicaid greatly reduced the money that people that work in mental don't receive. For instance, New Day Clubhouse, it's a great model. It's a great support system for people who are in recovery. Mental Health America South Carolina has a clubhouse in Charleston and one in Columbia. Because of that cut, they actually had to lay people off, which means that the person who needs the support the most will somewhat suffer from that. Fortunately, our county delegation, as well as the other counties around the state, spoke up. They had meetings. So they are going to increase that amount. per hour, not back to where it was, but at least something they can live with, and they are going back retroactive to March 1st. So that, just to show that, you know, all of us working together can really get something done.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, the next item on the agenda is to receive information and take desired action in reference to an ordinance to amend Chapter 2, Article 5, Division 2, Spartanburg County Code Ordinance relative to the Spartanburg Alcohol and Drug Use Commission to provide for a change in the name of the commission, which better encompasses all the elements and services and treatment provided to the residents of Spartanburg County. Now we have Ms. Sue O'Brien and Melissa Ann Cunningham, board member, to present.
Just me. Hi, as you'll remember, I was here last month and kind of gave you the whole context of why we were looking at changing the name, and I believe, and Catherine, correct me if I'm wrong about this, that this is sort of that first step for county council to work towards approving that and changing our ordinance in the county. So I don't have any new information from when I was here a month ago, and I'm sure you don't want me to go on and on again, unless you have any other additional questions or if there's anything else, Catherine, I should get to that.
I entertain a motion to render first reading to the ordinance.
So moved. Second.
All right, any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. None opposed? All right, and the second item on the agenda is receive information and take desired action in reference to the SADAC grant application for the bridge. We have a couple items on the agenda.
We do, and they're going to be a little bit out of order because I'm going to present on the first two, and my new prevention senior program coordinator will be presenting briefly on these. And these are all annual grants that we get every year. The ones I'm going to be speaking to is Project Q. That's a grant that we apply for under United Way for $25,000. We've had this Project Q grant for over 25 years, and the purpose is to provide specific women's programming to address the particular women's issues that arise. And that is, like I said, we've had that grant, we've applied for it every year for 25 years, varying degrees of amounts, but this year we're going to be applying for $25,000 for that program with your approval on that. The other one I'm presenting on is our bridge grant. We are now in our 23rd year of having a bridge grant, which is an adolescence and family outreach program. That's a program where we have therapists, counselors who go out into the community and provide services for adolescents and their families. Anything from helping them with school supplies, to rent, to counseling, to transportation. As I said, we're in our 23rd year of that grant, and we would like to, again, with your approval, apply for a grant of $123,807. And then I'm going to ask Joe Pania, we'll just all do it one shot. This is Joe, the Attorney Prevention Director.
Yes.
Councilmember, yeah. Chairman Bell, we will need to take them one at a time. So Sue has gone through the bridge grant renewal, and unless council has any additional questions for her, if we could go ahead and take that as item C and then we'll move to D.
All right, that'll be good. So do I have a motion to approve filing a grant application for the bridge grant renewal item C?
So moved.
Second.
Any other discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. None opposed? All right, and then we'll move down to item D, the community change through alcohol and tobacco compliance bias grant.
Yes. Good afternoon. Thank you for allowing me to speak. The community change through alcohol and tobacco compliance bias, we are asking with your approval to apply for a grant from the United Way for $25,000. This will allow our tobacco alcohol compliance team to perform compliance checks throughout the county, as well as perform education through the Palmetto Retailers Education Program. This, of course, will help to reduce the access to alcohol and tobacco by minors through these compliance checks. That helps to make sure that vendors are aware of what's going on and they're doing the correct thing with their ID. And we ask for your approval to submit that application to the United Way.
Do I have a motion to approve filing the grant application?
Second.
Any other discussion? And we've already heard the presentation for item E. Do we have a motion to approve filing a grant application for the United Way Project Q grant?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, raise your right hand. None opposed. Thank you.
Thank you. One more, the United Way Youth Advisory Board.
Okay, yes.
We are asking for your approval to apply for an $18,000 grant. We have had, the Youth Advisory Board has been in effect for over, we're entering the 26th year of that. It teaches, or it's a class designed for rising 9th grade through 12th grade, so high school students throughout the county, to be taught a certified curriculum for alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs, and they're taught and educated as peer leaders, and then they go then out into the community to provide presentations to their peers, and also perform community service and learn leadership experience as well. So with your approval, we'd like to submit an application for the United Way Youth Advisory Board grant.
Okay. I entertain a motion to approve filing the grant application.
So moved.
Second.
Any other discussion? All those in favor, let it be known by raising your right hand. None opposed. Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Mr. Chairman, no other items before our committee.
Thank you, Mr. Bradley. Next, we have personnel and finance. Honorable Bob Walker, Chairman, Jeff Horton, Jane Hall, member. Mr. Walker.
Mr. Chairman, we have two items of action tonight. First is the fiscal year 2016 budget presentation, budget calendar, and Ms. O'Neill will share with us what we're planning on doing.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is the first step in the budget process. As we've done in the past, I'll be giving you just a brief overview of the budget to prepare for the budget work session, which will follow depending on if you adopt the schedule on May 4th. So giving you just an overview of this process as we begin it, the general fund, which we'll really focus our attention on today, the estimated revenues for this fund are $89,297,000. This is roughly a $4 million increase over last year's estimated revenues. So the requested expenditures, that represents the budget requests that the county received. So it would be from departments, outside agencies, anyone that is allocated funds through the general fund. The requested expenditures that were submitted were $95,014,741. So just to kind of put some reference to that, bless you, in fiscal year 15 that we're in right now, the expenditure request was $90,989,103, so roughly $91 million. So I offer that to you because I wanted to be sure that you recognize that the requests are still trending up. And there's a lot of reasons for that. There's a lot of pressure that is being placed on the delivery of services by the county. But I just wanted to put that together for you so that you can see that the job that we faced in preparing a recommended budget is to reduce the requested expenditures by roughly $5.7 million. And our intent is to submit a balanced budget to you within the estimated revenues that are presented here at your work session.
Catherine, before you proceed, yes, would you read your underlying motivation of putting this budget together this year? Just read the vision of Spartanburg County on the yellow page. Everyone in here, on the bottom of each page, we have the mission and the vision of Spartanburg County, and that's how this budget is derived. So would you read that for us?
Yes, sir. The vision, Spartanburg County's vision is to be a preferred destination for individuals, families, and businesses to live, learn, play, and invest. And our mission is, Spartanburg County provides a foundation for a superior quality of life for residents, unlimited opportunities for business, and an exceptional learning environment for education through purposeful planning, investment, and use of resources. And truly the budget ties into that through the use of the resources. One of the guiding principles that our team has used in preparing the recommended budget that we'll present to you at the work session is to meet as many of your goals and initiatives that you established in your strategic plan session, your strategic planning session, as we can. And we'll denote those to you as we go through the work session. So the requested budgets and what is comprised in this particular slide includes all of the department requests that we've received, all the new initiatives and programs, the personnel requests, the capital requests, and what our anticipated revenues are. So that takes us to the revenue contributors, what makes up that roughly $4 million increase from the current fiscal year. So roughly 90% of the revenue, new revenue that we have estimated in the budget comes from taxes. So this is real estate, vehicles, business, personal property. Our collection rate trends are up. The amount of revenue that we're receiving from our FELOs also is comprised in that new revenue. So roughly 10% is comprised of permits and fees. So we are seeing a higher number of land transactions and our development activity levels are up. So this would represent an increase in the revenue from building permits, registered deed stamps, planning fees, and so on. With regard to fines, we're generally seeing that revenue trending downward, and as you're aware, there hasn't been any movement to adjust the local government fund to reinstate its statutory formula. So I have not incorporated into any of your revenue any increase in local government fund. It is at a static level. You'll also see when we get to the budget work session, there's an increase to the elections reimbursement, but before you go too far with that, it's also offset by additional expenditures. So that carries us to what is driving the expenditures up. There's a couple of things that we have to build into the budget really automatically as we prepare it for you. Retirement contribution rates are increasing. This was a planned increase. So for the regular retirement, that would be the majority of our employees. We're going from 10.9% of the contribution rate to 11.06. And in the police officer's retirement, we're going from 13.41 to 13.74 as a percent contribution. So as we looked over the staffing requests that were provided, of course, council has asked us to prepare a pay package in the recommended budget, which we will. We're also seeing our service level demand increase. We're just seeing more traffic. As an example, last month we had 711 building permits. We've been hovering in the 400 to 500 permits per month range. So we're definitely seeing more traffic in our offices. And that's just one department. We'll talk about other ones in the budget work session. We are anticipating, relative to the fiscal year 15 budget, a fuel cost reduction. As you know, we build in a contingency if that should change. We're seeing an inflationary growth in utilities and other operating expenditures. We have a significant amount of deferred capital needs that you will see in the recommended budget as being funded as a priority. With regard to insurance, while we have seen some minor adjustments to our tort liability insurance, the one that I'm sure that you're the most interested in would be what has happened with our state plan for health insurance. They are assessing a 3.4% increase to all employers, not just to the county, so this is across the board. Our experience rating did not change, so there'll be no load factor added in the next fiscal year. So just as one side note on health insurance, the state health plan has also indicated that there will be an adjustment in the employee contribution as well. As a general guiding principle in the budget process, we've worked to reduce the utilization of the master lease as a financing strategy for our capital. As most of council and new members are becoming more aware, we moved to a master lease probably in the 2008-2009 time period, and that funds a lot of our vehicles, ambulances, our vehicle replacement plan, and we also used it as a strategy for information technology. Last year we took our first step away from that and cash funded IT, some of the IT components in the recommended budget. You'll see we're walking away from the master lease even more this year and paying on a cash basis or pay as you go, which is something that I think you hear about quite frequently as a positive financing model. So that takes us to the budget calendar. That is a preview. If it is agreeable with council, We'll be wrapping up our final review of the department requests about a week from now, which would put us on track to have a budget workshop and first reading with you on Monday, May the 4th. It looks like 10 o'clock on Monday, May the 4th looks good on all of your schedules. So if that time works well for you, we would schedule a budget workshop from 10 until noon. If you need any additional budget workshops, we can schedule those between May the 4th and your second reading and public hearing on May the 18th. And then third reading would be scheduled for June the 15th. Both May the 18th and June the 15th would be your regularly scheduled meetings. So, Mr. Chairman, that concludes the overview that is our starting point, has become our traditional starting point in this process. I'd be glad to answer any questions or have any additional information that you may want answered.
Right, for us new members of the council, the May 4th meeting is basically just getting the information to us, getting it out as far as the first reading.
Sure. We'll provide you with the recommended budget, and we'll walk through it during the work session. So what we ask council of you to help move the process forward is to have first reading at your budget work session. Of course, there's two more readings in the public hearing before the budget will become final, but that just helps us move forward in our process. That you would have the opportunity during the budget work session to not only receive a presentation on the general fund as well as the non-general funds, so those would be a whole array of budgets that aren't dependent on the general fund revenue as a primary, or really in some cases any source of revenue, to the general fund and non-general fund presentation to you. And the rest of the work session is an opportunity for questions and answers.
And this is a public meeting.
Well, absolutely.
Right.
We ask the department heads, we work with their schedules to have the departments here too. So if there's a question that is more detailed, then perhaps I didn't feel comfortable answering, then the departments are also.
Do I have any questions?
I got Mr. Chairman, committee, but how much of a push would it be to have our first budget workshop in the April session every year?
In April?
Is that kind of too close?
Probably have to move the budget calendar about. And I only say that because since I've been here, I've made an effort to meet with every department and outside agency. And what I mean by outside agency, it would be like Spartanburg Community College and others who we've been here with Charles Lee Center and others. So we need to move that back. And I've been hard pressed to have all of those meetings and conduct regular daily business. But if that's something that you'd be interested in, certainly can try to move that calendar.
I'm just thinking in years past, we've come up against the deadline. You know, according to this calendar, we have to have two meetings in May, and then the third reading has to happen in June prior to the 30th. It may not push us up against that clock so hard, but not a lot. And it's tough to get to May, so I know that you push it to get back in April, so I'm just wondering how that fits in your schedule.
Sure. So one thing that may be helpful is when council, you talk about having a strategic planning retreat each year, perhaps in September, perhaps in January, like you did this year, we have another budget-related strategic vision session where you help me with any of the initiatives that you really want to see included in the budget. Because at the end of the day, I'm trying to accomplish your strategic plan and provide you with a budget that is satisfactory for you, as you have this year indicated that you'd like to see it balanced within your revenues. I understand that's my charge. So we can certainly add whatever pieces that you want in this. The more time I have in preparation, the more realistic the revenue estimates are as well. Some of the revenue estimates that you see here are based on collections that happen each month. The estimate becomes stronger and stronger each month as we go forward. So there is some help to waiting until late April, early May, because you have the most refined revenue estimates we can apply.
Is there any certain procedure that we have to have a certain amount of time that we need to read in?
Mm-hmm. your local rules would supersede that. The most controlling piece of this is the advertisement for the public hearing that has to be placed on the paper, I believe that it's 15 days prior to the public hearing. If you'd like to have a series of meetings, we can have a pretty good, and a lot of meetings between May the 4th.
That's what I'm getting at. I mean, there's nothing to prohibit us from May the 4th to June the 15th having additional meetings in there, right?
I think that your only local rule that applies to is a 24-hour notice of a public meeting, so you need to notify the public in the media that you'd be having a special call.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, the only comment I have about that, I was looking at getting most, if not all, of our meetings during a already set council meeting and try to do our budget in that format instead of asking the public to take some time out of their day, and they may not have the opportunity to comment on this place.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to also throw this out. I've done this on occasions in the past years. But I'd like to see us move toward a every two-year budget as opposed to doing it annually. I think there's a lot of other counties that do that. I think they'd be successful in it. And I also think it wouldn't be so taxing on our departments if we knew for the next 2 years exactly what the budget was going to be.
Sure, I really wanted to do that this year, but until we level out on our revenue forecast, I'm uneasy doing that. When it becomes more of a trend that we can estimate, I think we're set to have in that direction. I just don't. Revenue growth that we're having right now, I'm not sure whether we're going to be able to sustain that. I hope that we will, but I'm not certain. Until we reach $92 million in our forecasted revenue estimate, we haven't even recovered from 2008, where our revenue was. So I want to get to the point to where we feel more that the revenues are more predictable.
Heading that way, but not there yet.
Heading that way, but not there yet.
All right, anyone else have any other questions, comments?
I'll make a motion to proceed with the calendar.
I second that.
We got a motion and a second to proceed with the proposed calendar. Any discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed, like sign. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. All right, next item is to receive information and take the desired action in reference to a resolution authorizing the county administrator to finalize and implement a new employee handbook with revised and updated policies and procedures, and expressly rescinding and revoking the Spartanburg County Policy and Procedure Manual currently used by the county. And each one of the committee and the whole council received the proposed policy at our last meeting, and we're prepared today to proceed that process. So do I have a motion that we adopt the proposed manual as presented by the county administrator and the staff?
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I believe that you're looking for a vote on the resolution that was included in your agenda package that encompasses all of the pieces that you were looking for to rescind the old handbook and the old guidelines So in your packet, there's a resolution that we're asking council to adopt that adopts the new employee handbook and instructs me as the county administrator to proceed with finalizing and publishing the new employee handbook. It also rescinds and revokes the current policies and procedures manual and any employee-related policies and procedures previously adopted by the council as policies to be included in that policy procedure manual. So if the motion could be to adopt this resolution, I think it encompasses all of the items that we'll need to do.
Right. I misunderstood. I thought that's what I was doing.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That we got a resolution to do that, and you have all of the material at your desk in your packet to do that. And, do we have a motion to
Mr.
approve?
Chairman, I make a motion that we adopt the resolution.
Got a motion to approve. We got a second. Now, is there any discussion by anyone? Anybody got any questions? I hear none. All those in favor of adopting the resolution authorizing this new implementation of the new policy manual guideline handbook, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, like sign, and it is passed. Thank you, Mr. O'Connor. The other, each should receive the updated financial data and the personnel makers report in their packets. That concludes all of our business.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Next, we have Livability Committee, Honorable Jane Hall, Chairman David Britt, Michael Brown, members, Ms. Hall.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. We're going to, in our first item, receive information and take desired action in reference to a grant application for the annual summer food service program. And Mr. John Woodsby, Recreation Manager, is here to present.
Good afternoon, Council. We are here to request approval for our annual submittal of the grant application for the USDA Summer Food Service Program. This will be our 35th year as the local sponsor for this program. We cover 11 sites throughout Spartanburg County with this program. Last year, we administered approximately 18,000 nutritious hot meals to children that qualify for the program. This year, we are requesting a grant amount of $84,632 to fund an estimated 23,440 meals at 11 sites in Spartanburg County. And those funds are 100% reimbursable to Spartanburg County.
We're not going to be funding any grant.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for discussion. All those in favor, raise your hand. All those, and we'll send this on to full council. Okay, item B is to receive information and take desired action in reference to a resolution to adopt preliminary plans for the renovation of Chesney Park, Cowpens Park, Inaree Park, Inman Sports Complex, and Packlet Park, as well as construction of the Lake Coulee Outdoor Recreation Center. Mr. Mike Nation is here, project Senior Project Manager, to present.
Thank you, Councilman Hall. Center is now under construction that will focus more on the Packlet Basin.
So these are the plans that we have to show you. As far as the community park renovations, we hired a firm to look at these parks. We had community meetings. We surveyed the existing conditions and identified what need to be, things that need to be improved, and things that we might want to add in the future. We also got some idea of what this might cost. Of course, our funding will be through the CIP fiscal year 16 request for the essentials improvements, which we think maybe would be around the $2 million mark for all five parks. We've kind of taken an unusual approach to this, since all the parks seem to have similar issues, parking, fencing, they all need new restroom concession buildings, lighting, renovated playing fields, signage, and just basic amenities like bleachers, benches, fountains, waistbands, and playgrounds, picnic shelters. They either need them or need them upgraded. So with those, everything needing similar type work, we kind of combined all the parts together into one large project and did this as a design build project, which would make it, we think, would attract a higher grade of contractor by doing a one large project instead of five small projects. I think it will be an overall lower cost, and we will get these things finished quicker. So that's kind of our idea of the approach on this. And we look to do the essential things first and then the desirable things in the future as money becomes available. The design build process, we've already had a request for qualifications out, and we've had, I think those qualifications are due tomorrow. Once the CIP is approved by our county council, we will proceed with the next phase, which will be selecting a firm and get requests for proposals with a not to exceed price for the final design and construction of five parks. We will work with, if the proposal exceeds the budget, we will reduce the scope or request additional funding if that's the case. And we will, the parks project staff will oversee these projects, and we're excited about doing this. The first one is Chesty Park. These are just the conceptual plans that we will ask you to adopt tonight. Chesty has parking issues. We can address that. Nutt, as I said, we have very similar issues. We will do a major connection with the Chesty Community Center, upgrade the fields, new concession restrooms. This is Cowpens Park, same issues. We will upgrade the fields, concession restrooms, new playground, picnic shelters, parking. As I said, all of these parks have very similar issues. The Sunny Acres Packet Park, we will add parking. We will enlarge one field so that it's usable by more youth groups. We will upgrade some of the existing tennis courts and basketball courts and add a playground. In the sports complex, we will add accessible concrete blocks like we're doing in all the parks. We'll do some upgrades of the fields, bleachers, signage. All these things we're doing at most of these parks. Innery is the fifth park, and it is the old Inman Mills Textile Park. Inman Mills has done some work there. we will be doing the upgrades, but it's really not feasible for us to maintain the park since it is so far away from our maintenance staff. So we'll be working with the community to provide maintenance with the occasional park department help for the big work. And this is similar to an agreement we had with the Little Africa Park that we're working with now. This is Entry Park, which has a lot of existing infrastructure. We'll be removing some of the things and also adding additional parking, playgrounds, multi-purpose field, basketball courts, picnic shelter, ADA, and making everything, of course, ADA accessible. The Lake Pulley Outdoor Recreation Center, the background of this is we've been working with SJWD, which has been a good partner of ours on several projects. We worked with them to let them kind of manage the project. It's going to be on their property at Lake Pulley. We have a preliminary site plan that we'll show you tonight. And once we have your approval of the preliminary plan, we'll continue with the design and the construction of this facility. This is the site plan. Lake Pulley is a great lake. The facility will be, it's the little gray thing that has the biggest view of the lake and the mountains beyond, so we think we've got a great location. It will be a facility that upstairs will be classroom facilities with offices, a restroom, storage. Below will be the kayak, all the outdoor recreation equipment storage, which we'll get that. Right now we have a container up there to store and all that, so we'll get that kind of cleaned up around there and allow us to do rentals out of this and also have an office for an outdoor recreation staff. So we're really excited about this. We think this can be a really good facility. We were thinking classrooms only, and then we had been with SJWD, and they said, of course, you know, some people want to rent this right away, so we're even looking into that aspect of being a facility that you can rent. It's going to be not unlike Lake Lyman Lodge. If you know, if you've seen that, it'll be that kind of style, lodge style. That's kind of the view from the lake or looking out to the lake. It'll have a garage door so we can get vehicles in there, trailers in there for outdoor stuff. So, next step is for y'all to approve these plans in concept tonight. We will, as far as Lake Pulley, and we will notify SJWD that they will plan to proceed with the design of the outdoor recreation center. We also recommend improvements for the fiscal year 16 CIP to develop a new contract with the Indian Sports Complex for review of School District 1 and also send out request proposals for community park renovation. And that's, I know that's a lot in a short period of time, but that's kind of what we're doing and what we're wanting to present to you tonight with the idea that you will, we ask that you approve these preliminary plans so that we can move forward.
At this time, I entertain, we have a motion to adopt the resolution.
Move we adopt the resolution. Second.
Okay, we have a discussion.
Yes, sir.
Mike, I understand correctly, the Lake Pulley project is funded in this year's budget.
Yes, sir.
It's already funded, so we're looking
correct.
At funding. We're looking at the funding for the other five projects
in fiscal year 16.
Just from the budget end, I want to make sure I understood that.
Yeah.
Go
ahead.
Jim, I'm going to direct this at you. I'm very, very concerned for several different reasons. But
one of the things that comes to mind is just because something's a good deal, doesn't mean you have to go buy it. And I totally understand that over the next 15 years, we've got $120, $150 million coming into the parks department that has to be spent on parks or trails or things of that sort. It seems to me that our original discussion was that we were going to, and you've done a good job of this, had 100-some-odd parks in the county, and we're trying to get rid of the ones that we don't need and trying to weed those out so that we reduce our operating expenses and really concentrate on the ones that are needed. And then last year or so, it appears that we're just starting to pick up a lot of things. It looks like, you know, we're getting good cooperation here and we're getting cooperation here, so we're able to leverage some of our funding and extra funds, and I think that's great, except that I don't know where this stops and where do we get to the point where 15 years from now, when the hospitality tax sunsets, that we're hurting in our operating expense and we're going to have to start raising taxes to increase the amount of funding to the parks department so we can support all the things that we're on a $150 million buying spree to purchase now. So if you could address that a little bit for me, it might ease my frame a little bit, but I don't think so.
Well, I wouldn't characterize it as a buying spree. I would characterize it as completing the parks enhancement plan that y'all adopted in 2012. That's all this does. The one variation on that theme is the Ennery Park, which came up after the parks enhancement plan was approved. All we're really trying to do here is, because when we surveyed all of these five parks, and they all had common issues, and they all had issues that if they are to remain open, we must fix, then we grouped them together, hoping to reduce the cost of getting all this done. Now, I put this in the Parks Enhancement Plan too. Essentially, when these parks are done in a couple of years, there are no more parks to be built because there is no more funding available to build large new parks. We think there will be funding to make small enhancements here and there, you know, add a tennis court, add a river access point, add a whatever. But in terms of like spending $1 million, $2 million on a new park, it's not there. Your issue about the hospitality tax and what's going to happen 15 years from now is a real issue. But on the other hand, as I said back in 2011, 2012, in terms of these parks that we're talking here and the other ones that we're working on, we only have three choices. We can close them, we can fix them, or we can accept the contingent liability that those old parks represent. And so, at the time, back in 2012, council made a decision to fix them, and that's what we're doing. Like I said, the only variation on that theme is the Ennery Park, which came after that 2012 vote. Of course, which of those parks y'all choose to fund or not fund is up to y'all. If y'all were to come back during budget deliberations and say, Jim, instead of this amount, you've got that amount, then what I would do is come back and say, okay, well, what do you wish us to cut? Because it comes down to this. I can't, in good conscience, recommend that we continue operating the park, which I know has problems. So that's the conversation that would occur, I think, during the course of your budget.
Jim, one of the things I'd like to point out is when you're talking about the CIP budget and you're talking about essential improvements, explain exactly what essential means.
They are the non-sexy things, let's put it that way. They are the things that are required by the Federal Americans with Disabilities Act. They are drainage problems. They are safety issues that erupted over the years and they haven't been fixed. But primarily, they're accessibility issues. We are not in the best of shape in some of our parks right now. And that's the purpose of trying to fix these things. I know it sounds like a lot of money, and it is a lot of money, but this is where it comes down to, this is y'all's decision. If we choose not to spend that money, then we also have to choose to not do something.
James?
Yes, please.
Jim's absolutely right. 2012, you look at these parks, and you look at where they are, Calvin, even though we've added Emory, Chesney, it was embarrassing to call them county parks for what they were, and it said a lot about who we were. I think it was absolutely the right thing to do, the right time. Not only are we trying to recruit people here, you know, with industry and business and people, we're also trying to afford the residents of Spartanburg County nice parks that they can be proud of in their neighborhood. Calpins, Chesney, Henry, Inman, they haven't had a whole lot. So I fully support it, you know, and I'm a very conservative council member, but it's the right thing to do because we're investing in the people who live here, safety, you mentioned fencing, bathrooms. You know, if it's going to be having Spartanburg County Parks Director in the name of their home, it'll be something I can be proud of. And this gets us where we need to be.
Well, it gets us to a basic level of what would be considered ordinary. But my thought is that if we get the non-sexy stuff, accessibility things finished, the restrooms finished, there's lots of philanthropic activity in this community. And once you have a place to put it, I fully expect citizen groups and foundations to step forward and fill that space out with playgrounds and other activities so that we can leverage what money the county has. We've done a good job of that so far, but we've got to fix the infrastructure part first before we start talking about bringing in a playground.
Duncan Park is a great example before the city took over. Those tennis courts, that racquetball court used to be there. All that fell into disrepair years ago. It was embarrassing. I ran by the facility for 30-something years to have our name on it. It was embarrassing.
Yeah, I think once again, I'd have to also point at our mission, which is Spartanburg County provides a foundation for a superior quality of life for our residents, unlimited opportunities for business, exceptional learning environment for education, through purposeful planning, investment, and use of resources. And I think we are staying on point.
And I'll say one other thing, too. You know, we're actually doing something that we figured out the other day with the parks planners of the world. They've actually come up with a name for multi-generational parks. Spartanburg County is getting older. And so now we're adding, we'll soon be opening up in June, a disc golf course to go with the walking trail that's at the Old Cannon Road former soccer facility. It is getting heavily used already. The exercise equipment is getting heavily used already, which goes along with the community's desire to have a healthier lifestyle so that some of those negative numbers that afflict Spartanburg County's population can start reversing. And we are seeing some of those things being used already. As I put it to folks, the market has changed a lot in the parks and recreation world. Once upon a time, mama took her babies down to the park and they played. Now sometimes it's grandma taking the babies down to the park and play. So while the babies are playing, why can't grandma walk around frail and keep fit so that she lives longer and has a better quality of life and ultimately stays out of the nursing home? So good parks are good public policy.
Jim, was it the Lake Cooley thing, was that a Spartanburg Parks home facility, or is this something new?
Well, the contract reads that it would be owned by Spartanburg, SKWD Water District, and would be it would be available for use of Parks Department. Therefore, we rent it, we get the revenue, that's what we funded.
Okay, but they didn't have Spartanburg Parks Department label on it. That's something new that we're we're doing. So all, we're not all talking about, oh, taking her parks and bringing them where they need to be. We're also taking on new projects. I guess that was my whole point, is that.
And that's the one thing that falls into that category among this list. And again, it was in that under that previous plan. But the idea was that everyone recognizes the Spartanburg rivers represent a good recreational resource. So we've got a possible place to base outdoor recreation in the form of the new Packwood Village Center. This would be on for the west side of Spartanburg, and would be a great place for outdoor recreation staff to teach people how to paddleboard, how to canoe, et cetera, on flat water where the risk is lower before they get into the rapids on the rivers.
Roger, if I may, there's only one thing I'd say in defense of that particular project is, David, you would, I think, remember years ago, the Spartanburg Water System approached us about helping them with Lake Playlock Park that is currently there. And I think we provided manpower to do the roads into the place. And I don't know if you've been out there lately, but they have expanded that park. It's beautiful. There's a lot of opportunities over there for recreation for families. So hopefully this will continue to blossom.
I think it will. And that's one reason we did our website the way we did. It's about parks in Spartanburg. Because there's a lot of stuff out there in Spartanburg County that people just do not realize is there. And we're working on wayfinding signs at the moment, for example. And the more we tell people it's out there, the more they'll be used.
Have we had a meeting since Easter? This is our first meeting since Easter, right? Okay. I have to add this, and then we'll go ahead and do our vote. I was out there for the Easter egg hunt. How many would you estimate were there?
Well, Christy Blackwood, she ran the event. She used the return. She counted the legs and divided by two. They got 2,000.
I'm telling you, we had, three or four fields with Easter eggs on it. Great activities, face painting, a lot of different things. But what really touched me, and if we have anyone from CBB here, I have to give them a heads up on this as well. I was standing by a man and woman as we were watching our daughter and granddaughter go out after the eggs, and he was talking about how wonderful this place was. And I said, well, thank you. You've been here before? And he said, oh, no, we're just traveling through. We're from Pennsylvania. And when we saw the Spartanburg sign, we Googled Spartanburg, and we came up with CBB and then went to the Parks and Recreation Department and we're camping, and we saw that you were having this event. It says, we do not have anything to compare with this field and these activities we were from, and we are just so privileged that we found this and participated in it. So the word is getting out. Our websites are phenomenal. And I thank you for the good work, because this is what we want, is people to understand what a livable community we really are. So thank you for that. No other questions? We'll go for a vote. All those in favor of sending this to full council, raise your hand. All those opposed? And this will go at our 5:30 meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Holland. Next, we have Public Safety and Judiciary. Honorable Michael Brown, Chairman, Roger Nutt, Bob Walker, members. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have one principal item coming before the committee. We have Mr. Mike Flynn, Communications Director. I'm here to present some information with regards to communications 911, submitting a grant application for partnership with the City of Spartanburg.
Good evening. This grant is the 2015 Homeland Security Grant administered by Bruce Slayer. A little background on it is the fact that the Spartanburg City Police Department, who we dispatched for two decades now, has not been able to flip the radio switch and speak to a sheriff's deputy who might be responding with them to a call. In recent years, they can't even flip their switch and speak to any law enforcement agency because they're on a UHF radio system. All other law enforcement agencies are on an 800 megahertz system. So it's their priority to get to an 800 megahertz interoperability. What that means for us is that we need some equipment in the comm center in order to dispatch them on 800 megahertz frequencies. That will cost, according to Motorola, we have a quote for $33,446, which is the amount of the grant that we intend to pursue on your approval.
Is that coming half of that cost, or half of the cost of the operation of that?
That's the full cost of the equipment that we need to do that. There's no match required. The only responsibility of the county is to prove that what we said it will do will be done after the funds are spent.
And I'll take care of any issues that the city may have.
I hope so.
Any other questions? I'll entertain a motion to approve the following grant application.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
All in favor, let it be known by aye.
Aye.
Send it to the full council.
Thanks, sir.
Mr. Chairman, those are all items that have come before you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. No items unrelated, other than hopefully in your packet. Next, we have Public Works Buildings and Grounds. Honorable Roger Nutt, Chairman. David Britt, Justin Bradley, members. Mr. Nutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today, Mr. Captain O'Neill is going to give us some information in reference to a geographic feature to name change from Greenville Branch, which obviously needs to be changed, to Butterfly Creek in Spartanburg County. Ms. O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The county's been approached by the U.S. Board of Geographic Names to ask for your support of a change to a feature, a water feature in the north side area to Butterfly Creek from Greenville Branch. The city and the county have both been asked for their support. The name Butterfly Creek, as I understand it, was suggested by the Cleveland Academy students. So unless council has any objection, we would ask for council support and give me the opportunity to share that with the U.S. Board on Geographic Names.
Would you authorize the county administrator to send a letter of support?
And a motion?
So, second.
And a motion and a second. Is there a street name also for this creek as well?
That's
not cool. No.
That's about
it. Can't be worse than Greenville Branch. Sorry. We have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? All in favor to authorize the county administrator to send a letter of support, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, we will send that on to full council. We're going to receive an information and take desired action in reference to an agreement with probation, parole, and pardon services. Ms. O'Neill and Mr. Nelson are going to tackle this one.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The probation, parole, and pardon services has shared with us their public service program that we can be part of. And I've asked Jamie Nelson if he would help us with a pilot program where we would receive clients from probation, parole, and pardon services who would help us as part of their community service hours. So it's my understanding, and Jamie can correct me if I'm wrong, it's my understanding that as part of community service, a judge may assign someone to work perhaps 100 or even up to 500 hours of community service, and they can be assigned to Spartanburg County to help us with a number of different projects that we have going forward, from helping with public works to helping with the landfill and our collection stations, to helping with facility maintenance, litter control, mowing, those types of projects. We could use the help. These individuals need to provide these services, and if council's okay with that, I'd like to enter into an agreement with them, and I'd also like to unfreeze an environmental enforcement officer position to help supervise this particular program. I've heard that there could be in the neighborhood of 100 to 200 clients that are awaiting assignment for their community service, so I'd like to get that pilot project going and seeing how many of those clients we can serve.
Move for the approval of the agreement, budget amendment.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? From permanent? Mr. Nelson?
Thank you.
You've done a great job here.
It looks better. Thank you.
I know your staff had this already, but you could probably squeeze 500 hours.
We're ready.
Somebody's hired. All right, thank you, Jamie. Okay, now we're going to receive information, take desired action in reference to an annual solid waste grant application to help maintain tower recycling management program. Ms. Watson, Recycling Coordinator, to present.
Hello.
Good afternoon.
How are you? Okay, so the tire grant is through SCDHIC. The county has been receiving the tire grant since 1994. Tire grant goes to pay for advertising and professional development, $5,750 total for that. It also provides funding for other direct costs to help manage the tire grant recycling program. For this year's grant, we are requesting $39,454 and some change in the hopes of receiving it to buy a Bobcat skid steer loader, which will help us at the landfill to load waste tires, among other things. So the total grant requested under the DHA tire grant is going to be $45,204.82. There is no county match required or requested through SCDHIC.
That's going to be my next question.
We approve the grants application.
I have a motion.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, that is approved. I think you're still up.
Aye. The second item is the DHEC Waste Oil Grant, another grant that the county has received since 1994, another grant that does not require county match. Allows funding for professional development and advertising, $5,750. Also provides funding for equipment and supplies, as well as direct and indirect costs associated with the motor oil recycling program. So we are requesting $3,750 for oil spill kits. So oil spills at the recycling center, we have the proper supplies to clean it up, as well as approximately $34,300 for new signage for all 17 recycling centers.
Just because Ms. Watson is so convincing and so much energy, I move that we approve the grant.
I have a motion to approve. Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Ms. Watson, 100%.
Thank you. I want to take one quick minute of your time just to let you guys know we had the household hazardous waste collection event. I know you're timing me. I saw that. We had 424 cars come through and collected a total of 30.53 tons of hazardous materials from Spartanburg County residents. Our community cleanup event in Woodruff had 267 cars, which was a 30% increase from Woodruff's event last year. We collected over 40 tons of materials.
So it shows the pace and advertise at the county council.
Good.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. Members of the committee, we have the other activities in your public works packet, so we refer to those. Mr. Chairman, as always.
Thank you, Mr. Nutt. Appreciate that very much. This concludes our committee meetings. And earlier we were in executive session. We still have two items that we need to complete. So I will do our dead level best to get us back in this auditorium by 5:30, but I need a motion to go into executive session.
So the
motion. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative. It passes. We'll be with you shortly. Thank you. Okay, thank you for your patience. Sorry for our tardy. Earlier today, we had our committee meeting, called order our regularly scheduled council meeting. First item on the agenda, the invitation, Chaplain Thomas Stewart. How are you today, sir?
Great.
You praise the rain today?
We got it, man.
You know someone else,
sir. That's right. Exactly right. Let's all stand. Let us pray. Father, our God, we thank you for another opportunity that you've given us to enter your presence through prayer. Thank you for what prayer brings to our lives. We thank you for all that you do. Truly, you are a good God, and you're worthy of all the praise that we can give you. We come tonight asking you to continue to bless Spartanburg County, continue to have your hand upon us, that we may lead in a way that will be pleasing in your sight and be beneficial to the residents of Spartanburg County. Pray for all those who are in leadership position that give leadership. Pray that they will be guided by you to do those things that you would desire to be the best for all of us. Thank you for tonight. Pray your presence tonight in this council meeting. We do all to glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Captain. David, you lead us in the pledge
tonight. Attention. Salute. Pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. So, item two, presentation. First presentation, recognizing the valuable services provided by Spartanburg Communications 911, presented by Mr. Mike Flynn, staff, presented by Mr. Michael Brown. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Like the resolution. Guys, come on up.
Come on around the front, if you like.
A resolution of the Spartanburg County Council recognizing the invaluable services provided by the Spartanburg County Communications 911 Department and proclaiming the week of April 12th through the 18th, 2015 as Telecommunicators Week. Whereas emergencies can occur at any time requiring law enforcement, fire, or emergency medical services, and whereas when an emergency occurs, the prompt response of law enforcement, firefighters, paramedics, and EMTs is critical to the protection of life and property. And whereas the safety of our law enforcement officers, firefighters, paramedics, and EMTs is dependent upon the quality and accuracy of information obtained from citizens who telephone Spartanburg County Communications 911 Center. And whereas public safety telecommunicators are the first and most critical contact our citizens have with emergency services. And whereas public safety telecommunicators are the single vital link for our law enforcement, fire, and EMS personnel by monitoring their activities by radio and providing them information, and of course ensuring their safety. And whereas public safety telecommunicators of the Spartanburg County Communications 911 Department have contributed substantially to the apprehension of criminals, the suppression of fires, and treatment of patients. And whereas each telecommunicator has exhibited compassion, understanding, and professionalism during the performance of their job in the last year. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Spartanburg County Council does hereby proclaim the week of April 12th through the 18th, 2015, as Telecommunicators Week in conjunction with National Telecommunicators Week and joins in honoring the men and women whose diligence and professionalism keep our county and our citizens safe. Be it further resolved that this resolution is presented to the Spartanburg County Council and the Spartanburg County Council's meetings to the Spartanburg County Communications 911 Department in recognition and appreciation of such services and be made a part of the minutes of the Spartanburg County Council adopted this 20th day of April 2015. Signed by Chairman Jeffrey Avorn and testified by our County Administrator, Catherine L. O'Neill. Mr. Chairman, that's the way the rules present this resolution.
Great, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, not voting affirmative, it passes. Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Awesome job, guys.
Okay, thank you so much. We just appreciate the opportunity that we have to provide services to the county. We love our jobs and hope that we can continue to grow and do better. Thank you.
And of course, we want to recognize through this resolution and express an appreciation for the pride and honor bestowed upon Spartanburg County by the achievements of Tim Watts, Spartanburg County Communicators, Communications 911, and being named Telecommunicator of the Year. Whereas pride and honor have been bestowed upon Spartanburg County by the achievements of Tim Watson, in that he is the 2015 recipient of the Telecommunicator of the Year Award by Spartanburg County 911 for his exemplary attitude, knowledge, and skills in the areas of emergency communications and leadership, and the ability to respond to unusual or special emergency circumstances. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Spartanburg County Council does hereby recognize and appreciate the achievements of Tim Watson, who has bestowed great pride and honor upon Spartanburg County and its citizens, which reflect great credit upon him as an example of good citizenship to be admired by all the people of Spartanburg County. Be it further resolved that this resolution be presented to Tim Watson in recognition thereof and be made part of the minutes of the Spartanburg County Council adopted this 20th day of April 2015. Signed by our chairman, Jeffrey A. Horton, and attested by our county administrator, Captain L. O'Neill. Mr. Chairman, I ask that we waive the rules and present this resolution to this young man.
Have a motion.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes. Thank you, Mr. Bray.
I called him personally before came out here today, so he guaranteed me we're going to have a 15-minute speech. Good man. Thank y'all.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Mr. Chairman, before we get started with item three, I'd just like to make mention of the fact that last week I was able to present a proclamation to the BASF Chemical Company in Whitestone for their 150th year anniversary, and they've been having a presence at Spartanburg for the last 42 years. I met some terrific employees with that chemical group. They're very proud of what they do, and their involvement in our community through the United Way and many other service areas is phenomenal. So I'd just like to give a shout out for BASF Chemical.
Thank you, Jay. Appreciate you doing that. Next is employee recognition, and Catherine O'Neill's been informed. But before we get to Catherine, there's two sad things that I need to bring before you today. Number one, I'd like to recognize Felicia. Felicia, raise your hand. Felicia is our reporter with the Herald Journal, and this is her last meeting. And I've been doing this for a long time, and Felicia, you've been one of the more conscientious, fair reporters that we've had. And Felicia's going to pursue a law degree. So I wish her well, and certainly going to miss you, but we wish you the best in new endeavors. Thank you for being a part of the county for how long?
2.5 years.
2.5 years, that's a record. That's a record for the Herald Journal for us. We have a revolving door here through the years. Felicia, you've done a great job. You've been fair, and you've done your research, and you've kept these citizens informed, and they should thank you as well. Here, here. Next, I'm sad to say we learned as a council member that our county attorney will be leaving us soon. Lisa has three small children, and she's accepted a position that will allow her to work from home with a national firm. So I think May 4th or so will be Lisa's last day. And for county folks, I think after our meeting on May 4th, we'll have a little reception for Lisa. But Lisa, you've done a yeoman's job. You came in and really took us from one position to another position. You did a tremendous job, you and John and Jenny. And so again, we understand. We hate to lose you, but we understand, family. And we appreciate and recognize the fact that you're doing what's best for your family. So with that, we thank you for your service.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to turn the employee recognition over to Councilman Bradley for recognition that he'd like to do. Councilman Bradley?
Thank you, Ms. O'Neill. If the individuals who are, as I call you, your name out, if you would just stand to be recognized. Lieutenant Matt Hutchins with the Special Victims Unit, Sergeant Tony Brown, Investigator John Kent, Investigator Heather Forrester, Investigator Tracy Moss, and Investigator Brian Wilkins. And the following individuals probably are not with us, but I did want to recognize them with U.S. Homeland Security Investigators, Special Agent Steve Michaels, and Special Agent Joseph Bartle, and with the Greenwood County Sheriff's Office, Investigator Shannon Hiller. Some of you may have seen the reports about a recent human trafficking case that was within Spartanburg County. It's an issue that I care deeply about, making sure that we look out for these victims of human trafficking for them. And I appreciate the work these investigators did on this case. I think Felicia actually was the one when I've been doing some advocacy on this issue, asking why does a Spartanburg County Councilman care about human trafficking? And the fact is, it's happening here in Spartanburg County, and we need to raise awareness of that and do our part to investigate those cases. So just to give you the details of this, in February 2015, Spartanburg County Sheriff's Office Special Victims Unit recovered a reported missing runaway female juvenile. While the juvenile was being debriefed, allegations were levied by the juvenile that she had been forced, manipulated into engaging in prostitution in a local hotel and motel. Follow-up investigation was begun regarding these new allegations. It was determined through the investigation that two different groups of individuals were utilizing various social media and other websites to contact, approach, groom, and present underage females for the purpose of promoting prostitution. Four different female juveniles were subsequently identified and recovered locally. Subsequent to the investigation, arrest warrants were obtained for seven different individuals, and a roundup was conducted by the Special Victims Unit, resulting in the apprehension of all seven wanted suspects. The Department of Homeland Security Human Trafficking Task Force has contacted us and has assumed the investigation. Since it's believed that some of the victims have been transported across state lines, and this investigation continues to be ongoing. But I did want to just thank these investigators for the work you did on this and really saving these victims from the life they were facing. So thank you.
To recognize a number of individuals who have helped us receive yet again the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting. So this is our 22nd year, and I guess Sabrina, the pressure's on. So it's been 22 years. We want to keep that run going, but I want to take just a moment, Council and I, to thank you, Lacey, Cole, Kelly, Lisa Benfield, everyone who worked so hard to make sure that our financial reporting is at the level and receives the Certificate of Achievement each year. 22 years is a good run. Thank you guys very much for representing the county so well. To recognize Steve Pettit. Hey, Steve. I wanted to tell you guys about this is in all my years of recognizing employees, this is pretty cool. So thank you for what you did. A gentleman was hiking the Palmetto Trail. He was en route to Coney County to meet up with the Appalachian Trail. As he travels, he keeps a blog in his journal and then posts his thoughts or adventures on the web. Inspector Pettit had passed this gentleman in the Pauline area several times while he was going from one location to another. The gentleman was sitting on the side of the road eating his lunch, so Steve stopped to check on him to see if he needed any help They had a good conversation regarding his adventures, and this was posted on his blog. He had Inspector Hood, I think, working for the Sheriff's Department. I'm not going to give you up, okay? No offense intended, but he's pretty amazing for us. So I just wanted to thank you. You know, you had a choice to make that day about whether you were going to stop and check on someone who was a complete stranger. And as it turned out, he didn't necessarily need your help, but he sure has a wonderful impression of Spartanburg County's hospitality. So thank you for representing us so well. Jerry Glover and Jerry Swan. I know everybody knows you, but would you guys please stand up? This is repeated recognition for you, and I certainly appreciate all that you do. The Home Builders Association of Greater Spartanburg commended how both of you have worked with DHEC regarding the septic tank requirement for the release of power to homes. As of March 1st, this requirement has been waived, and residences now will be able to get their permit and power can be initialized. I know that there are many times that we ask you to think inside the box, outside the box, with no box. I appreciate you stepping up and understanding what we needed to do here to help our homeowners. And I just wanted to say thank you. I know council says thank you as well. Thank you. Lastly, Mark and Jess, please here. He's sick. Well, it's probably because you guys have been working too hard, right? Wanted to take just a moment and recognize Justin, if you'll pass this along to Mark as well, before council. Every now and then I have an opportunity to kind of bring you up to date on the accomplishments of Mark and Jess and Jonna, who just left us, I guess, Friday for a position that she took with their application development project. Just as an update and a thank you to you guys for doing such a good job. We have moved forward with the Register of Deeds software implementation, the human resources software rewrite, the on-base document knowledge transfer and compliance module, a big part of the whole project. Moving forward with the auditor's on-base implementation and the finance department on-base implementation. These things, you take small steps every day to get us where we need to go, and as a result, we're more efficient for not only our own operations, but for those things that we provide to our citizens as services. So, Council, if you'll join me in recognizing Jess and Mark for a job well done. Kim, I know you're proud. That's all I have, Mr.
Chairman. Thank you, Governor. Item 4, public hearings. I open item 8, considered application for a special public event excluded from the order on it. That's by two things. The Karen Buddhist monks from 4 p.m. until 11:55 p.m. on Saturday, May 23rd, 2015. To have an offering to the death of family at 841 Shiloh Church Road. Anyone speak on behalf of this public hearing? None seen. Close A. Open B. To consider an application for a special public event excluded for the North Owners, requested by Jose Maceda from 4 p.m. until 11:30 p.m. on Saturday, April 25th, 2015, for a birthday party at 327 Tara Woods Lane, Delima. Anyone speak on behalf of the public hearing? None seen. Close B. Open C. To consider an application for special public event excluded from the Norris Ordinance, requested by James Martini, Bowling Springs Ale House, from 6:30 p.m. until 10:30 p.m. every Thursday starting April 23rd, 2015 through May 28, 2015 for music on 9 and 2220 Bowling Springs Road. On behalf of public hearing, I know we have three people signed up to speak, and just be cognizant under the public hearing that we're limited to 5 minutes each, and then we do have one person later on in the public comment period, and it's 3 minutes. So with that being said, the first person that I'll call forward will be James Martini of 229 Mason Drive, Inman. Sir, how are you?
Thank you, City Council. I'd like to start off first saying that we are a family restaurant. We do a lot of things for the kids. We've made several donations to several different schools. We currently have Mickey Mouse there, and every Monday we got different characters for the kids. The music online, we did not mean to get this uproar about this. We care about our community, and we want to give the people in our town this great event. It was very great. We made different plans in place to make the noise go a different direction up the highway to help our neighbors out. We've also like to make an adjustment on the time. We asked 10 o'clock, we'd settle for 9:30. It was a great environment, great people. We had doctors there. We had doctors' offices. We had a lot of good people coming to this restaurant. We asked our town to give us a chance. We go out of our way, and that's what we're about. We're family. We got kids. We respect this. But last year at this time, we struggled on Thursdays. We watched downtown Spartanburg get a lot of our business. We were empty until a certain point at night when people started coming back into town. Like my job is to be aggressive. I went out and I had an idea and I went with it, and it was a great time. We just ask y'all to take it into consideration, and we'll bump the noise down. We'll do anything we need to do to make this happen because it was so great. That's about all I have tonight.
Anything else you want to add?
No, sir, I'm done.
Thank you. Appreciate being here today. Next, we have Charles Wyatt of 518 Chippendale Lane, Bowling Springs.
Bowling Springs is convenient enough that residents can seek out many musical events in a matter of minutes throughout Spartanburg County. But in the case of the Amplified Music Concert at the Ale House, the music sought us out instead of the other way around. For my family and my surrounding neighbors, on March 26th, the first outdoor concert was loud. We couldn't go outside. We couldn't enjoy our living space. We couldn't enjoy our backyards, our decks, our patios. Our children couldn't get to sleep that night. As you probably know, many complaint calls were put to the Sheriff's Department that night. Residents also complained to their Homeowners Association asking that these concerts be stopped. A lot of those residents are here. Some of the Homeowners Association folks are here. Tonight you're being asked for a noise ordinance exemption that will allow this to take place for several Thursday nights over several weeks. As residents of the area, we find this request to be unreasonable. The noise ordinance, particularly the part about unlawful amplified noise, was put in place for reasons such as this. We feel that this exemption should not be granted because the music is disturbing our peace and quiet. We're also concerned that the exemption will open the door to other requests for exemptions on additional nights, whether it be this company or another company, or from surrounding businesses that might want to do this on a Friday night or a Saturday night or a Sunday night. Allowing this particular exemption will basically tell the residents that one night a week, our peace and quiet will be disturbed, and they'll be relegated to staying indoors to avoid the noise of this event. While the business patrons might enjoy listening to outdoor music, our residents would also like to enjoy their outdoor space at the homes that we work so hard to get. And again, we're not opposed at all to this business having an outdoor event, not one bit. But we are opposed to the amplified music that is annoying all of our local residents. So we're here asking you tonight to honor the spirit of the noise ordinance by not allowing this exemption. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wyatt. Next we have William Bland, 426.
He said a lot of what I was going to say, but thank you for letting us come up here. Thank you, guys. And I see exactly where you come from. I also have a business, and I understand how tough it is, brother. And I want you to know that from the bottom of my heart, man, I wish you well, and I'll continue to wish you well. Regardless, I trust this forum. I know I believe it's God-ordained. I appreciated the prayer at the beginning. The only thing I'm worried about, really, I don't have a lot of money, but I spent a good amount of money to live where I live, and I chose to live where I live very carefully for my family. And the precedent of the exception would be what would bother me if it's going to be that we can apply again and again for an exception to the ordinance. What good is there to have an ordinance? And you mentioned a few other ordinance exceptions in the beginning, and each of them were for one day. And I understand this one's just for a few days, but what if we have to come back and this is over and over again? That's my first concern. My second concern is just the proximity to the amount of residences. That particular area is just so condensed in homes that my concern would be it's really going to be a bother to a lot of people, and I don't know for sure that was a consideration for you moving there to have your business. And finally, he already went over, so I appreciate you guys listening to us and to them too. I trust you. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Clay. Right. That concludes item C, public hearing. I'll open item D to consider an application for a special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Greer Dragway from 4 p.m. until midnight on Saturday, May 9th, 2015, and Saturday, May 23rd, 2015, for a drag race at 1792 Dragway Road, Greer. Anyone speak on behalf of this public hearing? None seen, close. D and concludes public hearings. Earlier today, we had our committee meetings. First committee was Economic Recruitment and Development. Honorable David Rick, Chairman. Mr. Rick.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The committee met. We recommend to full council that we approve the bylaws in reference to the bylaws of the Upstate Workforce Investment Board and the Consortium of Cherokee, Spartanburg, and Union Counties for the implementation of Public Law 113-128. Move that we adopt and approve this bylaw.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, any ayes.
Second item also relates to the Workforce Investment Board. The committee recommends the full council that we approve the agreement in reference to the consortium and administrative agreement between the Upstate Workforce Investment Board and the chief elected officials of Cherokee, Spartanburg, and Union Counties. Chairman, I move we approve this agreement.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on item B. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative and it passes.
Next item also relates to the will. Committee recommends, I make a motion to approve and authorize the County Council Chairman and the County Administrator to sign in reference to the Workforce Development Area Designation Petition for Upstate Workforce Investment Board.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative and it passes.
Last item on our committee, we passed a motion and we will make recommendation for full council as it relates to the REWOP, which is the Renewable Water Resources. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to put a motion to amend the recommendation of the committee to clarify the geographic area and composition of the REWOP Commission to include a member who resides in Spartanburg County, and specifically, committee would authorize the county administrator and or chairman of county council to write a letter in support of resolution number 5-2015 related to CPW and the adoption of REWOP service agreement with geographic area to include area defined by Greer CPW resolution number 5-2015, as well as the geographic area generally bordered by Regal Road, Highway 101, Highway 417, and the Ennery River, be more completely defined by legislation submitted to the General Assembly, and the composition of the REWOP Commission would also expand to a member who resides in Spartanburg County. So moved.
Our second, Mr. Martin. We have a motion to amend and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative and it passes.
Now I'd like to make a motion that we approve the amendment to the motion I just made.
So the motion.
Yep.
We have a motion.
Second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative and it passes.
Chairman, that concludes our committee report.
Thank you, Mr. Brett. Public Health and Human Services, Honorable Justin Bradley, Chairman. Mr. Bradley, I think you have some fans in the audience tonight.
I do. I recognize my wife, Faith, and our daughter, Madeline, as well as our new son, Reagan.
Righty, good to have you tonight.
So the first item for our Public Health and Human Services Committee was to receive information in reference to the Mental Health America Spartanburg County. Second item, committee recommends that we render first reading to an ordinance to amend Chapter 2, Article 5, Division 2, of the Spartanburg County Code ordinances relative to the Spartanburg Alcohol and Drug Abuse Commission to provide for a change in the name of the commission, which better encompasses all the elements of services and treatment provided to the residents of Spartanburg County. I so move.
We have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
And the third item was to approve filing of a grant application for the bridge grant renewal. And I so move that we approve filing the grant application.
Second.
All right, item C, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
Item D, the committee recommended that we approve filing of the grant application for the community change through alcohol and tobacco compliance buys grant. And I submit that we approve filing the grant application.
Right.
Have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, and the vote affirmative, it passes.
Item E, the committee approved filing of the grant application for the United Way Project Q grant. And I move that we approve filing that grant application.
Sorry.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, now vote affirmative, and it passes.
And the final item that came before our committee was approval of filing the grant application for the United Way Youth Advisory Board grant. And I move that we approve filing of the grant application.
Sorry.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, that vote affirmative, and it passes.
That was all the items that came before our committee.
Thank you, Mr. Bradley. Next, we have Personnel and Finance. Honorable Bob Walker, Chairman. Mr. Walker.
Mr. Chairman, we met earlier today. We approved two items on the agenda. Number one, we had a fiscal year 2016 budget presentation by our administrator, and she presented us with a budget calendar for the preparation for next year's budget, and we move to the adoption of that calendar.
We have a motion.
Second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, no, vote affirmative, and it passes.
We also received information and approved a resolution authorizing the county administrator to finalize and implement new employees' handbook with revised and updated policies, procedures, and expressly rescinded and revoked the Spartanburg County Policy and Procedure Manual currently used by the county, and we move for the adoption.
Have a motion.
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
Mr. Chairman, that concludes our report.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Next, we have livability. Honorable Jane Hall, Chairman. Ms. Hall.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, we received several items today. The first is to receive information and take desired action in reference to a grant application for the annual summer food service program. I move that we approve the filing of this grant application.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, no, vote affirmative, and it passes.
We also received information in reference to a resolution to adopt preliminary plans for the renovation of Chesney Park, Cowpens Park, Innery Park, Inman Sports Complex, and Packlet Park, as well as construction of the Lake Cooley Outdoor Recreation Center. I move we adopt this resolution.
All right, have a motion. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative.
And that is it for our committee.
Thank you, Ms. Hall. Next, we have Public Safety and Judiciary. Honorable Michael Brown, Chairman. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had one item that first became before the committee. We received information, had a request to take desired action in reference to communications 911 grant in partnership with the city of Spartanburg. I recommend, based upon the committee's recommendation to the council, I make a motion that we approve the filing of the grant application.
Have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, no, vote affirmative, and it passes.
Mr. Chairman, those are all items that came before our committee.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. No items under land use other than what was in your packet tonight. Next, we have Public Works, Building and Ground. Honorable Roger Nutt, Chairman. Mr. Nutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Public Works met earlier today, and we discussed and so moved to approve a name change for the Greenville Branch to Butterfly Creek in Spartanburg County.
We have a motion for a name change and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, it passes.
Mr. Chairman, we also discussed and moved to approve an agreement with the Probation, Parole, and Pardon Services.
We have a motion. There's a second. And just if you were not here earlier today, this is an exciting program. We're partnering with Parole and Probation. And for those that have community service, we will implement that with Mr. Jamie Nelson. And hopefully the public, if you will send your roads with litter, needs grass cutting, ditches clean, hopefully we'll have some additional resources in the future to assist with these items throughout Spartanburg County. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
Catherine, we're going to handle the budget amendment later.
Yes, sir. It's in your packet for
All right. Just wanted to make sure. Mr. Chairman, we discussed and also moved to approve an application to help maintain tire recycling management program for solid waste grant.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, it passes.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, we also discussed and so moved to approve a solid waste grant application to promote the waste oil recycling program.
Have a motion. Second. Any other discussion? Raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, it passes.
That's it for our committee, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Next, we go to public comment period, and we did have an individual sign up, two individuals sign up. We have Ms. Janine Froman, P.O. Box 160207, Bowling Springs, to talk about hospitality tax.
Thank you for allowing me to speak. I'm speaking today as a stakeholder and a taxpayer, not as a resident of Spartanburg County. I live in North Carolina, on top of the mountain in Columbus, North Carolina. But I have owned Henson Management, which is the largest property management company in Spartanburg County, for over 30 years. And I have been for a long time and remain very, very concerned, as Roger, which you stole my thunder, thank you, for asking the question about when is this going to end. I relate this to the two divisions in my company. I have the rental division, where I manage property for owners of upscale rental property. They all want their income, but they don't want to maintain anything. That's the problem, maintaining. And all the problems that we heard today about the parts that exist were maintenance issues, unfulfilled maintenance issues. In my HOA division, everybody wants a pool, but nobody wants to maintain it because it's expensive, very expensive. There will be no end to it, Roger. And the reason I say that is because this is the Spartanburg Trails and Greenways Plan that was approved by this county council in late 2014. 6 weeks after it was approved, and I was here when it was approved, with very little information given to anybody, just like very little is given out to anybody at any of these meetings, I went to my Rotary Club meeting and had a presentation about the cost, the true cost of the Trails and Greenways Plan. There were slide presentations taken directly from this document that the citizens of Spartanburg County paid $15,000 for of the combined $45,000 that it costs to make this. It talks all about how to do it and how to sell it. Not one word about how to maintain it. Not one. Now, that's ridiculous. The cost, right here in print, for everybody to see, a multi-use trail, cost estimates per mile, $1,089,217.20 a mile. Do you know how many miles they wanted to propose? 110. 110 miles. Now, I love parks and I love trails. I've done backpacking.
We'll give you another minute, but it's from...
When I was young, the answer to this and the reason that the only way we're going to end this, in my opinion, is that anything, any project that uses hospitality funds, the maintenance required to maintain that project needs to come from those funds. The ordinance that Jeff signed says that that's the way it'll be done, but it's not. I need you to look at that.
Thank you. Next we have Whitney Farr of Greenville, South Carolina.
Thank you, County Council. I come to y'all tonight just to discuss a little bit of the road maintenance in Spartanburg County. A lot of our roads are falling apart, as many of y'all probably know. The state is pushing right now legislative to do something with the roads, whether it's road tax, discussion, trying to get roads back to some of the counties to help maintain them. I have a resolution that y'all will probably not find tonight discussing that, and the County Transportation Committee being over that state county council. At some point, we've got somebody going to start spending some money on our roads, but we're not going to have any roads. I mean, I've got roads around my house. If you can look on the roads, and they're state roads, I mean, the county, most of the county roads are in shape, but even the state roads, you can walk on, you can fill up asphalt, move under your feet, it's gone. I mean, there's mud coming through the roads. And I don't know if I'm going to pay more taxes or do anything. But we have continual businesses, big industry trying to come here, Cabelco, Tory. You know, there's discussion, I think there's a reading tonight on in lieu of tax stuff for them. When are these companies going to start paying some tax back to the counties to help maintain the road? I mean, it's the people that work for the companies, it's the trucks that run up and down the highway to deliver their goods. They're destroying a lot of our roads. River Road was widened probably, I don't know exactly, but early 2000, River Road was repaved from Anderson Mill Road back out toward Greenville, four lane section there. There's potholes out there, you know, a foot and a half in diameter. I'm not saying that I can't speak simply as a county or state road, but somebody got to start maintaining these roads. You know, I say the majority of the money that the state spends is spent in a little part of the state. That's because the majority of people from the upstate go to Myrtle Beach and Charleston in the summertime for vacation, so they're going to maintain those roads to a higher, and we have people from all over the country to go there. They're going to maintain those roads at a higher level than they're going to maintain our roads, because that's where the tax dollars are. We've got to look at something, whether they're coming from the state, because they're going to give us our road back eventually. We're not going to be able to afford to keep them up. A lot of it goes back to the construction of the road at the same time. I mean, I look at certain roads that was paved 20 years ago, but they still holding up, and certain roads that they don't hold up 10 years. Based off of asphalt, different grades of asphalt, different things that are used with them, influences of how long they hold up. And I feel like they need to do some studies on that and figure out where we're going to go with these roads, because y'all are trying to get people to come here and bring jobs here, but we can't maintain the roads to keep them here today. To get them here, we're not going to be able to keep them here. I was in North Carolina 2 weeks ago, the roads were clear. I used to work in North Carolina. Their roads are totally different than our roads down here. They just have a better room system. Georgia, I think Georgia's a little bit, overall, a lot better interstate and back rooms than what we have. For the amount of people we have here, we got to spend more money on our room than what we're spending.
Thank you very much, and we all share your concern.
Mr. Chairman, can we make sure he understands the...
Wait a minute, lady.
Right.
He is in rebuild, can you take care of that part?
I know, Mr. Farr, I'll be glad to talk to you.
All righty, thank you very much. This concludes our public comment period. Now we go to old business. Item A, render third reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee and tax agreement between Cabelco Machinery and Spartanburg, South Carolina. So moved. We have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion?
Mr. Griffin, paying a fee instead of taxes, does that mean they actually pay no taxes, or are they paying a lot of money?
Mr. Farr, I want you to be listening to this too. When you see your fee in lieu, that means, it doesn't mean they're not paying taxes. That means they're paying taxes just at versus 10.5%, like the state has set up for years and years, now down to 6%. North Carolina, the same industry, would be paying 4%. So we're not giving money away, they're not having to pay taxes. In fact, every industry we give a fee in lieu pays from day one, when they start putting equipment and when they buy the property. So there's no free lunch here in Spartanburg County.
any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes. Item B, render third reading to an ordinance to amend the agreement for development of a joint county industrial park between Spartanburg County and Cherokee County, so as to include additional property in Spartanburg as part of the joint park related to Cabelco and Torrey Five.
So moved.
Second. I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, passes. Item A, new business, consider an application for special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Two Thing from 4 p.m. to 11:55 on Saturday, May 23, 2015, to have an offering to the death of family at 841 Shiloh Church Road, Welford. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
All right, second. Any other discussion? Does anybody second? Did you say something about it? Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Do we have a second? Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, it passes. Thank you. Item B, consider an application for special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Hilsing Macedo from 4 p.m. to 11:30 p.m. on Saturday, April 25th, 2015, for a birthday party at 327 Terra Woods Lane, Lima.
Motion.
Motion. We have a second. We have a second. On a birthday party.
So moved.
All righty. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, affirmative, and it passes. Item C, to consider an application for a special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by James Martini, Paula Springs Ale House, from 6:30 p.m. until 10:30 p.m. every Thursday, starting April 23rd, 2015 through May 28, 2015. For music on 9 at 2220 Bowling Springs Road, Bowling Springs. Do we have a motion to approve?
No discussion.
You have to have a motion to have
motion.
A discussion. Do you have a second to get a discussion?
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Now, any further discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. We've heard from both the proprietor and the citizens in the area. The proprietor seems to be ready to make amendments. What is going on? Is there a way that we could do a temporary amendment to this to have a trial and then come back next month and make a final decision?
Well,
or do
since
we need
we're in
to
discussion,
stipulate?
And I guess it's appropriate. I could ask a question. Is that correct, Mr. Benson? By the way, you have great food there. You have great sandwich once, okay? And I enjoyed eating there. I know you had one concert, and I was out of town and was not able to be there, so I do not know how loud that it may have been in the area. I guess one question is, I know we do have kids in school during this period of time. and, you know, you have exams and everything that goes along with that. So I wonder why you selected that time frame and not maybe later in the summer to do this. From what I understand, Music on Main runs through the summer, you know, downtown. So, again, you might want to, in my opinion, sit down with this homeowners association and see if they would be willing to accept a different time frame, and maybe after school is over with, if they would accept that. I don't know. I've lived there 55 years, and 20 years and 3 months ago, I was a new kid on the block here, just like Justin. My first vote was for an entity in Greer. I went out there and I looked at the situation, and I was the only one, Dave, you'll remember this, but I was the only one to vote to allow that exemption. Everyone else turned it down. But the reason was they were there before these other folks that were complaining. And this situation is a little bit different. So based on what I know about the area, I don't know how you can turn that around as loud as it was and not affect someone somewhere. You just have subdivisions everywhere. And like I said, I wanted to be there, but I was in, I forget where I was, on business somewhere. I couldn't make that evening. But Jane, you know, with this, there's a lot of homes or apartment complexes in every direction that they turn this. And I want this entity, you know, to be successful. But, you know, I would suggest that, James, you maybe meet with the ones that are going to be affected. We had two names here tonight, and just see if they're willing to, you know, to take it at a different time frame, but after school is over with, perhaps, and see if you can work out some deal there. And if these two individuals that took time today, and we received a lot more emails against than for, okay, and that's going to be normally the way this thing occurs. But, you know, I think you have Josh Brennan band there. Josh, great band. In fact, I'm going to his concert at his dad's place, which we approved here, I think, this weekend. So, with that being said, I'll conclude my remarks with that I would prefer they work out an agreement. David?
And I see Mr. Wyatt's still here. I think Mr. Bland left. Or did he yes. come back?
No.
Mr. Wyatt, I know where this restaurant is. I don't know where you live and how much that sound did travel. How close do you live to
it? Yeah, we're in Sterling Estates subdivision on Chippendale Lane, kind of circling around back behind there. And by the way, I said it earlier, I'll agree with you. I told the newspaper reporter and I told the TV station, best wings in town. I mean, don't get me wrong, I like these folks. It sounded like the band was in my backyard.
Yeah.
And I don't know how turning that stage is going to fix that. I don't know how turning it down is going to fix that. And again, our concern is the precedent. What if the Mexican restaurant next door wants to do it and they come to you? Then we're living in a concert hall. We didn't sign up for that. The public events that are downtown are public events. This is a private enterprise. This is not a charity event.
Could you hear it in your house?
Oh, yeah. Kept turning the television on. My children couldn't go to sleep that night.
See, that's a problem with me. As a parent, grandparent, you know, let's say, y'all go off, and Sterling Estates been there, as Jeff said, a long time, a lot longer than the restaurant has. And to have that, you know, that music invading, or whatever type noise, that's one of our biggest problems from property owners. And that's why it used to, I guess in Spartanburg, it used to be kind of like Wild Wild West. You know, we've changed that. I mean, we really have to listen to what our homeowners have to say. And business as well, we're very pro-business, but a person who's invested in a home, who have children in there, and Jeff said, trying to study, I'm trying to get them to go to sleep, whether it's my grandchild or myself. I get up early in the morning. I don't want a rock and roll band keeping me awake until 11 o'clock at night or 10:30. I don't want to invade my house. So, you know, I agree with Jeff. If you're going to meet with them, this will have to be after school and try to work it out, then have them and you come before council.
Can I show you something?
Please. Yeah, I'll show you.
This is that gentleman's address. This is Warm Springs Ale House. This is his address. My plan for the stage is here. Last time I had the stage here, pointing to this area. I want to shoot it down number 9. Well, there's not going to be
But for him to say it was in his backyard, sir, I think.
Well, I printed it off too, and I mean, I did my own Google search today since I hadn't been up there. See, there's your restaurant right there. If you point it that way, there are a ton of homes back here.
That's right.
Well, yeah, sound travels like this.
Yes,
it doesn't just go straight.
Highways, well, I was trying to get at it.
Yeah.
Last time it was a direct
hill. Noble effort, but the sound's going to go back that way as well, and there are a lot of people who live back there. There may be apartments, but they're still Spartanburg County residents. Yeah. You see all these houses here?
Well, last time I had a direct hill, I understand I messed up on that part.
Yeah.
I really thought if I should have done number 9 with the traffic, done by 9:30, I'd tone it down.
Well, again, during school time, you go meet with the homeowners association. And like I just said, try to work it out.
Well, there's one thing, Mr. Lindsay, again, I appreciate you trying to do this, because I've lived there 55 years next month. So, and I want you to be successful. But there's one thing in this picture that I'm certain was not there when you had your last conference, leaves on trees. Yeah. So maybe you get a little buffer, later in the year if something occurs.
Can I say we did do one last year, and that's why I didn't think I had that permit. Yeah. We had over 200 people, no complaints last year. Nobody called. And I think it is the leaves on the trees, so.
Yeah. Well, plus it may have been a one-time occurrence. You don't know what's going on. All of a sudden they find out it's Thursday night on 9. And I've heard your restaurant's fantastic. I even heard your event was great. People said it was a happening place. It was fun, family-oriented, nothing bad.
We're just trying.
But they, I sympathize with the homeowner, in this case, a lot more than I do with the restaurant.
I would just encourage you to, maybe see if you cut the hours or whatever, but get it after the school time and let the leaves get on the trees, and maybe it'll be a little more effective. I'm not sure, but. Thank you for being here. Yes, sir.
It'd be nice if we could see this work out among the people who are involved in all.
Yeah, well, I agree with that, Jane, and that's what I recommend. And again, I believe that putting on trees may aid in the best some. Maybe if he changes the direction, but unfortunately, I don't know if there's too many directions right where he's located where it would affect someone somewhere, but we'll still let those guys work it out. Okay, anyone else want to speak on this? Need a motion. Well, we got a motion and a second. Sorry. All in favor of the exemption today, raise your right hand. All opposed? I'll vote negative and in favor. Thank you, sir. All right, next we have item D, consider an application for a special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance, requested by Greer Dragway from 4 p.m. until midnight on Saturday, May 9, 2015, Saturday, May 23, 2015, for a drag race at 1792 Dragway Road, Greer.
Move approved.
Motion?
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative. Passes. Any other things, Ms. Catherine?
Yes,
we have our bar amendments. We have a motion.
So moved.
Have a motion. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative. I need approval of March 16 minutes.
Have
a motion. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative. And a motion to adjourn. Second.